What's up, everybody?
What is up?
Come on in. Come on in.
Hey, welcome to Friday Mentor Session Q&A. Ask me anything.
We're doing it all. Welcome, welcome. Welcome to our members on Zoom, and we're right here. Welcome to our guests on YouTube. We're doing both today. If we have this set up correctly. Can you hear? How's that for diatonic movement? Welcome Friday. I hope you guys are having a good time. What's up, Jayla? Okay. We are doing a mentor session here at Open Studio like we do every Friday, and today it is a Q&A. I'm Peter Martin, and I'm going to introduce myself. I'm the founder and pianist and here at Open Studio, and I love our community. I love you guys. I love so much that you're here joining us. We're going to be here for about an hour, maybe a little longer. We'll see how it goes. Just answering questions and having a good time. Talking jazz piano, but beyond just jazz piano, we're going to be talking just sort of jazz and music in general, kind of whatever you guys want. And I'm going to do a little bit of introduction. I'm just getting my screens right so I can read everything about what's coming up. We do these every Friday. This has become one of the most, I think, important parts of our community here at Open Studio because it really includes all members. Of course, with the Open Studio Pro program, we have a lot of live things happening all week, but this is kind of the thing, the time for everybody who's available and wants to come to this. A lot of people watch it recorded. It's always available for members as well. But we do it, and we have some cool themes, and I just want to tell you a little bit about what's coming up here. Boom, 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 if I can find that. Here we go. Next week, October 13th, we have Kevin Hayes. Now, I don't know. I think a lot of you probably know who Kevin Hayes is, or you've heard him. He's one of the foremost jazz pianist that I admire of our generation, of my generation. I think we're right about the same age, and I've been listening to Kevin, and playing, having him sub gigs, subbing on his gigs, and just kind of intertwined with him since, you know, the early 90s, and he is truly a master pianist. He's played with everybody from Sonny Rollins. Well, when you play with Sonny Rollins, you can just sort of leave it at that. But the title of his mentor session, this is going to be in exactly a week from today, October 13th, Friday, is The Magic of Voice Leading. And I'm already looking forward to that because I'm all about the voice leading, so I can't wait to get his take on it. That's a subject area that there's so many, you know, diverse ways to approach it and everything, so that's going to be cool. And then the week after that, we have Jeremy Levine on October 20th, and a number of you may not know him, although you might have seen his excellent Instagram account, which is, I believe, called We Art Play, and he's doing a mentor session on how to play like Robert Glasper, and I love that title. He came up with that, and I'm really interested to see what he's going to do. He was actually a former student of mine from years ago at Northwestern University, the School of Music up there, and is doing wonderful things, and so that's going to be a fun breakdown. The recording of this session will be available on your dashboard under Mentor Sessions, as always, so you can come back and check that out. That's about it. We're going to jump right into questions here in a second. And I'm going to kind of, you can leave your questions on YouTube, but if you leave them on Zoom, I might give it a little more priority because that's where our members are at. But I'll try to get to as many as I can. How are we looking in there, Andy? Are we good? We're good. Producer Andy says, producer Caleb is on vacation. Must be nice. Producer Andy says we're all good. So I'm just going to bring up both of these and we're going to get down to it. Doom, doom, doom. Okay. Boom, boom, boom. I'm seeing YouTube is lighting up a little bit with some questions. Then we got some. What's up, Kevin? Okay. Kevin says the best way to ingrain chord tones when practicing improvisation. Okay. So chord tones can mean, several different things. When we're talking about improvisation, I think like a lot of these things, if we can kind of start with the basics, especially stuff that we want to be able to hear and build up for that. So like C major, You know, in terms of ingraining, like the triad is such a fundamental and foundational part before we add the upper extensions that a lot of times we take it for granted because we want to get to the fun stuff, right? All these different things that we can do. But the triad, even if we're not playing all those notes within our voicing, say, for instance, a rootless voicing, is that foundation. So those are the most important chord tones for us to be able to hear and to understand. So when we build up, or, but I like going to that sharp 11, that triad is what we hear first. And the thing about a triad is it's a major third and a minor third. Right? So as we go up from there, those intervals, we're trying to hear that as well as just sort of what the fundamental part of the chord is. Major third, minor third, major third if you go to the sharp 11, minor third, and then back up to the root, right? Because then when we do alterations, you know, kind of non-chord tones, we're hearing them in relation to those chord tones. So we want to ingrain that in us even if we don't play them all the time. So we can sing along. And then you kind of start this 9D, sharp 11, getting out of my range. Anytime we play something and sing along with it, it's great, but then we want to kind of go next level and start to sing it before we play it. And then we're kind of checking what we're doing with our playing. So it might be 1, 3, 5, or raised fifth. What else is the raised fifth? Flat 13, regular 13. Right, flat 13, so you can kind of test yourself. Major 7, dominant 7, flat 9, root, dominant 7, flat 6, that becomes the minor third. So I'm starting to hear. Then you start to take something to another key that you just played so that you immediately kind of challenge yourself to hear it and, you know, kind of reframe how you're hearing it. So that's one way to go about it, Kevin. I hope that helps some. Okay, we're lighting up with questions. That's what I'm talking about. This is a Q&A. Okay. Mark is asking, I've noticed you use finger substitution technique. Not being trained as a pianist, I'd love to hear your take on this. How important is it? How to practice, etc. It's important for me to be able to kind of get the sound out I want, and I think potentially it really... For most pianists, it's definitely on a more advanced technical level. So once you get to sort of that level, I think it can become very important. As long as, like anything, as long as you use it in the right situation. But even if you're more kind of beginner, intermediates, it's still something you can start playing around with. In fact, that you should. I'm not a big believer in, like, you know, harmonic concepts or technical piano concepts, even if they're advanced, that we shouldn't at least learn about them and start thinking about them, you know, earlier. It's just like if you're a basketball player and you're going to hopefully be tall at some point, tall enough to dunk, you're still trying to dunk even before you don't wait to even think about it until you get to be that height or that leaping ability. You're already trying and reaching for that. So I think this is one thing that can be done. And so just to sort of explain, I think what we're talking about, finger substitution, it's a matter of... It's when you're switching fingers as you're staying on a note. So this typically happens a lot on ballads. So if I go, and then I switch from my 5, can we see that in the, I don't know what you guys are seeing. Let me see here. Yes. Oh yeah, you can see a lot. So there I'm at 4th finger, or I say 4th finger to 5. And then if I'm gonna go up to the D, I would switch. I'm still holding it up to, so the first level of this is 5 and 4. The reason it's kind of advanced is because your 5th and your 4th finger, of course, what does that call this? The ring finger? I do have a ring. It's on the other hand. Is your weakest for a lot of people, or for most of us starting out. So this kind of switching is a little bit of a physical challenge. But the point of this musically is that you can... So now I'm not using any pedal. The pedal really should be assisting with you being able to connect. So there I actually switched from 5 to 3 because I already knew I wanted to go like with my line. The whole point is I want to play something that would be like, but if I'm playing chords, I got to switch sometimes to be able to make that connection because almost all the melody is going to be from my 3rd, 4th, and 5th finger, right? And being able to come under like that is kind of a pain. So it'd be like, so, but the most basic level, like I'm saying, is 4 to 5. And as we're going up, 5 goes to 4, right? 5 to 4. Now, it's very easy to say, like, why don't you just use the pedal? So I'd be like, see, look, I do it automatically. I'm in the habit of it, which is not actually as hard as you might think to get into that kind of habit. But it does take a little bit of intentionality with your practice, you know. Practicing a scale like that, and I'm trying to still keep, yeah. Ooh, I like that angle. My pinky off of, so I'll go up to 3. But trying to keep that pinky and even the 4th finger, if possible, off the black keys. All right, cool. River McNabb. Now that is a great name. Shout out to River McNabb. Do you have any thoughts or insights on going from idea salad to complete arrangement? Yes. Okay, I love that, idea salad. Get everything in the salad and then take everything out that isn't essential. So when you're practicing an arrangement, when you're working on an arrangement, that's the time to try a bunch of different things out. Now, when we talk about a bunch of things, that could be like structural elements of the arrangement, like introductions and segues, vamps, playing the melody, improvisational sections, you know, all these different pieces that we have at our disposal, free improvisation. But then it's also structural things like reharmonizations of the melody, maybe a rearrangement of the melody even. But like we're trying all these different things out as we practice, as we work on the arrangement, much in the same way I would approach composing a tune. I don't look at arranging as that different than in terms of like the creative process as composing, arranging and composing. It's just with arranging, you have a set structure for the tune, possibly the melody and that kind of thing, but then you can still deconstruct it and things like that, whereas composition, you're kind of starting with this clean slate. So what I like to do in terms of the idea salad is really get all those things down, just like I would be writing them out as I'm composing. The arrangement, maybe you need to write it, maybe you can keep it up here. But, for, well, like what I was just doing kind of, so if I was gonna work on an arrangement of this, body and soul, I might say get to this part, and say, okay, let me see if I can get a reharm on that. Ooh, that's nice. Where can that go? So now I've got a little extension I can do to go back to the second A. So I might write that one down because I probably forget it if I like it. Then as I'm going through and kind of practicing it, I play it with all those and then maybe start to pick out the ones that I think work best together with the other ones. You don't want to keep that salad with too many things happening, but you want to have the essential elements. You don't want an iceberg lettuce salad with no dressing and no other vegetables or anything, but you don't want it like so jumbled up that it's too much. So that's kind of a matter of taste, but I find that taking away, don't be afraid to put things in as you're working out an arrangement, but then don't be afraid of taking things away. Even if you love them, like fall in love with them because they work on the arrangement as a whole, not because you think they're a really cool thing. And so there's a lot of stuff I come up with like that, that I like at first, but then I'm like, you know, it doesn't fit the vibe of how I'm actually playing the tune. It's just a cool little, you know, a cool little reharm there. You can always make a note of that, keep that on another page, and use that at another time. All right, cool. I'm going to jump back up. David asks, I'm working on playing faster, and in particular, I hear attractive rhythmic patterns and shapes to play, and hear gold tones, but I'm wondering how to build up a vocabulary, or better yet, a series of strategies to find notes to go with those fast rhythms. Yeah, so, you know, sometimes when you're practicing, if you deconstruct the different elements that go into improv and then keep things slower than sort of your target tempo of playing fast, that can be nice. So that would be a matter of like working on just rhythmic ideas and then just melodic ideas. So, or and then just harmonic ideas. So what that would look like is, body and soul. So I'm going to go just rhythmic now. Is one of the hardest ones. Like I'm only changing the melody or the harmony. Well, I'm trying to make it melodic, but I'm still playing over the harmonic flow of the tune, but I'm not using any melodic or harmonic sort of devices. I'm only using and concentrating on rhythmic devices for the improvisation, but I'm still trying to make it sound melodic and interesting, if that makes sense. And I'm still playing the harmony, in fact. So it's always melody, rhythm, and harmony are our three basic elements at sort of the top level. There's a lot of different levels underneath that, of course. Or is that the bottom level? I'm not sure. But the three kind of, you know, like as like a family tree is coming down, you'd have those three elements. So we're thinking about as we practice concentrating on one or the other. You know, that can be very important, especially when you're in a very focused segment of your practice on improvisation, because that will really narrow things down. It's obviously a form of restrictive practice. It's one of the simplest forms, and I think most effective forms of restrictive practice. Attractive rhythmic patterns and shapes to play. Yeah, so the shapes, this will kind of decouple those two things for your practice so that you have a better chance of being able to like really be able to hear something and tell your story when you get in the moment of playing fast, when you don't have time to think and you kind of have to just react. So shapes can really potentially be melodic or harmonic in nature. So that's a really effective thing to decouple as well. So like the first chord of this, E flat minor, right? If you look at that shape, that's a melodic shape, right? But it's also a harmonic shape. So if I change the melody, it changes the harmony. Right? And I'm not doing anything really rhythmically. I'm sort of out of time here. So maybe I play those shapes. But this is mostly like a harmonic movement, but it's sort of manifested it within the melody the same way before what I was playing like was rhythmic, but it was manifested in the melody. And I'm playing out of time. So in order to really decouple these and be able to take advantage of the restrictive practice, you have the mistake you might make would be to do this. Ah, see. Which is fine, but why not take the time element, the rhythmic element out so you can really concentrate on harmonic shapes, okay? And then you can apply that kind of philosophy, I think. It doesn't have to be perfect or whatever. It's no problem if you combine a couple. But the more you can kind of keep those separate, I think the better. Okay, finger substitution we talked about. What are your thoughts on using Okay, Dan asks, what are your thoughts on relying on your eyes to navigate the keyboard as opposed to working deliberately on playing without looking? So I think it's important. Develop both. Okay, so first of all, you may not always have your sight. You may play, the lights might go out, it might get darker, you might start to lose your sight, you know. Maybe you get a crick in your neck or something. I don't know. I always like to think about, like, what's the worst case scenario, and am I going to be covered, and then hope that you don't get there. But there's also situations where your creativity might take your hands, like, out to this point where you want to still over body and soul. So, like, in order to be able to play out here, you can't look at both, at least not directly. So, like, if you end up looking in the middle, you're seeing with your peripheral vision kind of both. But if you get sort of active in your left hand, you got to sort of do it by feel. So it's a combination of those things. And the way that you can practice it, talk about easy ways to apply restrictive practice, close your eyes. Okay? So you can start with... scales, but they can be, you know, however you're practicing scales. You know, challenging yourselves with the different ways, but really with your eyes closed. Any kind of technical practice, you know, arpeggios. In anything that you would practice, just do it with your eyes closed, slow things down. What that's doing, of course, is developing your sense of feel and your sense of distance. So when we talk about, like, how things feel, like if I close my eyes or if I look up and I want to play like an A major chord, so I know I'm on A major now because I'm feeling, but I can't go right to, I can kind of go like, because I know I set up in the piano, you know, my seat, kind of belly button at the middle C, because all my teachers when I was little told me to do that. So I know, like, that's probably an A. Yeah, I was right. But you can't always just go by habit. Pianos are a little different, seats can be different, but what you can do, so like, did you see that right there? I think I went here, but I could feel, I knew that was the B flat, so you're definitely going by feel. And then once you're in there, you're going, but what if I want to go up top here, like to a, okay, this is gonna be, I think this is C major. Yeah, there we go. So, I mean, you can get lucky too sometimes, and obviously you always have the option to look, but what it is you would practice doing different things without looking at all. So, but you have to play the same kind of things you would normally play. So I'm gonna play like a C blues now. I'm gonna close my eyes and I'm gonna try to go right to it. And C is, okay, so I did that by, that's the other thing. Of course, you're using your ear. So I screw the, I see. All right, let me start again. So I'm just coming fresh here, F. So I'm making a big jump there, and I got lucky on that one. I'm making a big jump there. The left hand is staying kind of continuous, right? I'm doing that by feel. Maybe put your hand in your lap, and then you got to come back and find it. I'm going to go for A flat. So I was one off. That's okay. So you start to kind of make those different feels. You make some mistakes, and then you see, use your ears where to adjust. I mean, there's a certain amount of ear training that helps from doing this as well, but it would be taking anything and challenging yourself in terms of just practicing with your eyes closed. Then it's easy once you have your eyes open. It's easier, at least. Do we ask questions here? Yes, you do. Oh, yeah, somebody said that already. Okay. TQ is asking, my lines sound choppy from chord to chord as I feel like I have to define each chord or emphasize the chord tones. Can you talk about ways to systematically practice making lines over several chords, playing through the changes? Maybe an example as a 2-5-1 on a simple tune. Yeah, okay, so the emphasis on this chord tones, first of all, you're halfway there because you're already hearing something that you don't want to hear. Like, there's nothing wrong with emphasizing chord tones, but if it isn't coming out sounding the way you want it, at least you've identified what that is. So you're probably talking about something like if we're in A flat, or maybe even like you're hitting a lot of like basic triad chord tones on the beat. I know I'm kind of making this sound corny and playing this chord, but I'm just trying to imagine what it would be like. But actually, the culprit may not be chord tones, it might be where you're playing them. So it's like, if you're like, so if I end my line, and I'm kind of manufacturing, I wouldn't necessarily play it like that, but I'm kind of trying to play a lot of chord tones in the hippest way possible. If you end your line, say, on the root, and it doesn't get any more chord tone-y than the root, you're better off like on the and of four, say, than on one. Like that's gonna give it a real sort of static sound, and you might want that sometimes, that's fine. But I mean, that's one way of thinking about it. Now you just said about 2-5-1. So let's think about playing over this 2-5-1, B flat minor to E flat 7 to A flat major, and playing through the chords. So instead of like, you know, like taking an idea and then putting it over each three different chords, which is what I did there, the idea being jazz arpeggio with some triplets, starting on the root on each one. I'm just gonna play through it. Now, I played all the chords, and I actually was very conscious about shifting as the chords changed, but I wanted to play through them. So how do we do that? Okay, we're thinking a little bit more, perhaps, with scale-based lines as opposed to arpeggiated lines, except when we come to the next chord. So if I go B flat minor, so I started out, first of all, a little trick is start out on a non-scale tone, even though you can play non-chord tone, even though you can play the chord tone right after it. So it's B flat minor, scoop it down as opposed to. So if I go, this is all diatonic over A flat or B flat minor during. And then I go arpeggiated but continue the line. Okay? So now how do we actually make that work? I know some of you are being like, well, that's great, but when I try that, it doesn't sound like that. Think about, as opposed to changing chords over a 2-5-1, think about changing drama. So where is the easiest place to add a drama in a 2-5-1? On the five chord. So if I've got one measure of B flat minor and then one measure of E flat 7 and then one measure or two measures, whatever, of the tonic. So now I've got some time for drama. So if I go, so there's a way I'm even taking a very similar shape and still making it sound like I'm playing through, I think it sounded like that, like I'm playing through the changes. So what I'm doing is just B flat minor, and then when I get here, I'm adding some drama. So I'm going all upper extension, but I'm playing a shape that's related to that, right? Flat 9, 3rd, flat 13. I'm cheating a little bit with the major 7, but it works. And that's the thing with the drama. Like, you can get away with a lot of this stuff over the dominant chord because there's already tension in there. We're just adding more tension. And plus, I'm kind of hitting it and jumping off of it kind of quickly, too. All right, I'm going to keep moving on. I could talk about those forever. That's fun stuff. All this is fun. Victor's asking, on the jazz etudes, how much do we practice each etude before moving into the next? What level of proficiency do we need on each of those? Okay, so they're meant to be a little bit a la carte in that you can jump around on them. I didn't really grade them, although the first ones are, I think, the most approachable and the easiest in a way. But I wanted them to be more like graded in terms of like, if you do go through, like, I think there's 27 of them. So like, if you went on the first one and had enough time to kind of, you know, either master it, but be able to go through all 12 keys in like a day or 2 days or 3 days, however long it took you, then you move on to the next one. Then if you go in order, I think they kind of make sense. They don't necessarily always get harder, but there's some sort of release valves in there too. So I do think going through them in order is good, but you can sort of jump around as well and certainly still get the same benefits if you were to go through all of them like that. But if you picked out 24 out of the 27, you wouldn't necessarily miss anything because the main concepts on them could be broken down into the flavors of them is bebop, blues. There's at least one sort of New Orleans flavor one, and pentatonics. You know, they all kind of follow into that. Even the one, there's one that's like triads, but even that is really a pentatonic based because it sort of outlines the fourths as well. But anyway, I think the main thing is sort of thinking about and recognizing those. There may be one more. Those four. Anyway, if you kind of get the flavor of each one and you've gone through them, you know, it can become sort of like what you're interested in. Oh, I want to get some sort of pentatonic stuff. I want to get some more blues stuff. So you could sort of gravitate towards those. But they're really meant to be like traditional etudes in that you can revisit them at any time for some, you know, technical foundation and, you know, what in fact is a certain amount of ear training that's built into them with the playing, learning them in all keys. But the technical challenge of taking them through the different keys in terms of fingerings that we have to develop, understanding how to play in the difficult keys and familiarizing ourselves more with those will always be present no matter when you come back to them. So they're definitely ones, I mean, they came out of things that I practice. That's exactly how I built it. It's like stuff that I've always sat down and played and then taken through different keys. So I think there's a benefit for doing them at any time. Mark says, in Adam's beginning course, he teaches a chromatic exercise and specifies fingerings. In a subsequent course, he reminds us to use that finger. I've been playing piano for decades and learned a different fingering. Is there a good reason to unlearn, relearn? I would say, you know, I'm not sure exactly how complex it is that he's got a fingering. I think for something that you're going to play like a scale, like a basic scale, say a major scale, if you did not learn the traditional fingerings, there could be a benefit, but you're playing a different fingering that works for you. I think there's still a benefit for learning the traditional fingerings and seeing if they could help you. And even if they don't and you discard them, it's still a useful exercise to go through. You know, it's kind of like if you're in the gym working out on free weights versus a machine. It's not going to hurt you to switch over to the machine and then switch back. It might be a personal preference things, but it might activate your muscles in a different way. And I think for fingering, we're activating our brains more than anything else. Obviously, it's physical because we're talking about which fingers go on which keys for different chords or lines or whatever. But I do think it's important for us to challenge us to do different kinds of fingerings. Now, the biggest challenge with this is that we're spending a lot of our time improvising. That's why I talk about scales or etudes, you know, the jazz etudes, 27 jazz etudes that I did or whatever, of really zeroing in on fingering, because that's your chance to be very conscious about fingering. When we're playing, obviously when we're playing fast, we're definitely not thinking about it, but even like what I started out with the finger switching, you know, I'm not thinking about that at all. Like I've gotten that to that, where we want to get it to is to that point where 90% of the time, 95%, maybe even 98 or 99% of the time, we're automatically sort of by habit of being seen different situations before, not necessarily played the exact thing, but been in those situations before, that we're going to the most effective fingering. So insofar as trying new fingerings at any point of your, you know, learning trajectory of this instrument, trying out new fingerings at appropriate times, I think, is always going to be of some potential benefit. Because what happens is sometimes we'll try a different fingering, and maybe you're trying out this finger switching thing that was brought up. Or say, you know, playing a diminished scale. Like, I learned it just using 1, 2, 3. I don't know if that's the most effective fingering, but I kind of keep coming back to that. But I've tried other fingerings that I've seen. The trick is, when you try other fingerings, you have to give it a chance for you to get used to it. Because when you try it right away, it's going to be awkward, right? It's like you're driving an automatic car all the time. Oh, why don't you try the stick shift? You know, some of the great sports cars only come in stick shift. And you try it out and you're like, it's awkward, right? With the clutch, and you know, and you're like, oh, this isn't for me. Well, you got to learn how to do it. You got to give it a chance to get to see if you're going to like it. And you and fingerings are not going to take as long as learning manual transmission, but it does take a couple of days. Like, you might learn that fingering and then come back to it the next day and try it again and then see. You got to give yourself a little bit of a chance, because there's a difference between comfortable and effective. What we're looking for is effective fingerings. If it works better for you to kind of realize what your sound is, and there's no better example. I mean, there's nothing comfortable about switching fingers and doing all this awkward stuff. It's much easier just to, you know, move up like that or whatever. You know, it's more potentially complex doing the finger switching. But once you start to learn what you can do to the sound and how you can affect, you know, this instrument to get a better vision of how you're hearing and making it more lyrical, then you get addicted to that. So the effectiveness sort of trumps the comfort level. And then after a while, you're in the habit of it and it feels comfortable. You know what I mean? So it's that, that's kind of a mindset way of looking at fingering. Always give them a chance. Spontaneous contrary on a diminished scale in thirds. That's some, okay. Well, again, that's just kind of, thanks, River. That's just habit, repetition, that kind of a thing. You know, there's a lot of things I can't do with this instrument. I try to like show things that I can do because it's more, makes me look better. But the idea of like, how do we expand always? How are we open to expanding our repertoire? Like, that's why when I come in here and practice, I don't practice that kind of stuff. I mean, I do sometimes, I should say. But I'm more apt to like take, I'll practice the concept, like a contrary motion in tenths or something over a scale that maybe I'm not as fluid with. You know, like to me, the altered scales, those are always been awkward to me. So that's something, and fingering them, you know, that's something I'd be more apt to come in and do some contrary, you know, maybe even change up the intervals. And that's pretty good, but it's not great fingering. So I would, or so many ways to screw it up and challenge yourself. But, you know, always trying to stay on that bleeding edge of finding things within these basic frameworks that we have of how to practice that can challenge us. Super effective. Yes, this is Steinway. Shout out Steinway and Sons. I've actually been a Steinway artist for like, I think 20 years now, which is kind of crazy. I recognize the sound. Yeah, it's warm AF. Okay, let me jump back a little bit. I'm sorry, YouTube. I'm going to try to get over to you, but we got so many member questions over here. Lucian says, so Peter, I've been going through the jazz piano jumpstart. Just wondering on the 12-bar blues and the 32-bar American song form. This feels like a dumb question. No dumb questions. Only dumb people. Just kidding. I don't even know why I said that. But I can figure out the root and shells very slowly and play very slowly. How does one get these into the finger and make the voice leading smooth? Is it just do it many, many times over and over and it will come on its own? It feels so daunting at this point, though I will persist. But really, how does a beginner practice this? I can hear the changes, but they're nowhere into my fingers. It feels overwhelming. I know it's foundation. Any tips or advice? Great question, Lucian. And yes, many repetition will always help. But I've been thinking about something and some other things in my life beyond music that I've been trying to learn. And that is like, how do we all know about the Malcolm Gladwell 10,000 hours. And of course, it's not going to take 10,000 hours. It might take 20. It may take five. It's just a fun thing to think it is going to take a while. But that should be kind of a, you know, like a nice pillow that we can hold on to, that 10,000 hours. It shouldn't be a scary thing. It should be like, well, this is going to take a while. That takes the pressure off for me to be able to master this today or even this week or whatever. So there's that. But there's also like, how do we leverage other people who have already done the 10,000 hours on some of this stuff so that, not that we take a shortcut, but that we find some ways in. And so I didn't used to think that this was possible. I used to be more hardline, like, no, you got to do your own 10,000 hours. You got to do yours. But in learning some other things away from the piano and away from music, I really wanted to find some stuff I could come back and apply for someone that has spent 10,000 hours, like, and more for sure. Like, how do I help somebody that's younger in their journey to be able to maybe, again, not shortcut, but to make some wiser choices as we go. And so, you know, some of the foundational things we talk about, the restrictive practice and stuff, like tempo in terms of your practicing is such a simple thing, but for some reason we keep forgetting it. Slowing things down, and we slow something down until it becomes potentially fluid, but not till we get to the point where we are able to sort of overthink. So you were talking about Root and Shells over the blues or the American song form. We'll take the blues. I don't know if that's jazz piano for beginners or maybe jump start. But anyway, you know, like a basic blues over C. As we're thinking about these chords and practicing just the shells, there's a tendency to think about root, seventh, and third, and then root, seventh, and third. Oh, well, maybe we should play it down here because that's better voice leading. But how do we get to the point where some of this stuff kind of gets automatic in our ears and, more importantly, in our hands? We have to push through. We have to practice stuff slowly for sure, but then we have to push, at least on some of our practice, a little bit out of our comfort zone, speed things up maybe, so that we don't have a chance to think about that seventh and the third, because voice leading and playing shells it has to become like kind of a like an instinctual thing at a certain point. So what's going to happen as you push through in part of your practice is you're going to be messing up, and you're going to be thinking, oh, I'm getting frustrated because I'm messing up. No, once you start messing up is actually when you have, making mistakes, I should say, same thing, is when you have the potential to really have some breakthroughs, to really have an opportunity to tweak your ears, to start to develop them, to start to find how this stuff actually works. The results that you will get from those mistakes are not going to happen right then. But what you have to do is get the mindset, and this is where maybe I can save some 10,000 hours, is to go into it knowing that you're going to have a part of your practice where you're making mistakes and giving yourself that allowance to do that, right? Then your mistakes can really start to benefit you without the downside of the frustration or the becoming demoralized from the mistakes. So I would take this and be like, all right, I know a C blues. Let me go to something that's a little harder for me. I would say F sharp, but that's a tritone away. Yeah, okay, so we'll do F sharp. So I'm going 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. Shells only. And I'm gonna do a 1, 6, 2, 5, right? So I didn't make any mistakes. So I don't sit and pat myself on the back and say good practice. I pat myself on the back and say, way to get no progress. Let's get the tempo a little faster. 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Couple of mistakes, but the restriction on it is just that the tempo keeps going. We're keeping the groove going, we're keeping the form. If we miss some of the shells, I mean, and for me, some of this is hard because I want to add some stuff in. That's a good restriction to do less, to go back to just those basic elements of shells, because if you can't do that, I can't really claim to be able to hear some cool stuff on top of a real fast F sharp blues. Okay, so have part of your practice where you're really pushing. Maybe you've got that and that's really good with it, and you're down with the root and shells. Root shell pretty then. plenty of messing up there, so I know I'm going to be making some progress. But the restrictions, both at the beginner level and at the advanced level, actually can be harder than you think, but super, super, super effective. All right, I'm going to jump over and do one YouTube question. And I'm going to go to the last one. So I don't know. That's a little trick. If you get something up there when I'm looking at here from Joel, how do you make improvising on a tune like All of Me interesting? All of those long dominant chords really kill me. Yeah, me too. So, and it used to, and it still does sometimes, but I started getting into a thing after a while of like, how do you turn a bug into a feature? How do you turn a smile upside down, a frown upside down into a smile? Like, let's look at it from another angle. So how do we take advantage of those long periods? So you can look at the melody. The melody's kind of tough too, right? We were talking earlier about scale tones on the beat. So if I'm improvising, the first thing I would do, and this is just kind of random, responding to your question, is I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, two bars of each of these chords. So C major, and then to that E7. But nobody says you have to go right to that E7, right? Did you hear what I did there? I stayed on the right hand on the C major. But I know my kind of pivot point between those, right? So then I make that kind of a fun thing. So it's like a little bluesy thing because I'm still on the C major. But then I resolve it. And then I'll give you some other ones. So the A7. So what I did there was I turned it into a little bit of a 2-5-1 because we're going A7 to D7. So I stuck. Well, as soon as I got to the A7, I can't remember what I did with the left hand, but we'll keep it on A7 here. But in the right hand, I'm gonna play. I know I'm going to that D7. And then the D7, I can kind of do the same thing. Wait, am I right? Oh, goes to D minor. And then I think it goes back to the. You know, substitutions can always be your friend too. So, like over a D7, I'm. Even if I stay on D7, I'm just playing around on A flat. Now, let me give you one other way of thinking about this. What about if we don't try to expand our framework of what we're gonna have available for us to play? What if we lean into just staying on those chords? Wait, am I playing the right tune? So I really played every single chord. I didn't shift early. I didn't play over the bar lines with the harmony that much. That's a great way of restrictive practicing, but how do you make that work? Because we don't want to have to always be pulling out magic tricks with the harmony. That's great to have, and we're going to want to go there probably at some point. But how do we just sit on the one, on the time? So I'm going to give you a little hack. Listen to Louis Armstrong. He was the master of this. He had such actually his harmonic approach was super advanced for the time it was, but if you take it into context of today, and I think he actually played this tune, I'm trying to remember what record it was. But anyway, he really emphasized the other elements besides harmony. So the harmony might have been very basic, but he was really dealing with melody and rhythm, right? So the melod, obviously the rhythmic element, I think I'm accentuating the swing and that kind of thing. But I'm taking that riff, connecting it and then using that as opposed to trying to use some kind of harmonic connect. And very precise with, you know, the rhythm. Oh, the fingering there. Look, I'm switching fingers. We can't be afraid to play basic stuff. Why do I keep going to D7? It's D minor. Then when you do go to something fancy, this is the first time I've done it. Flat 9. You know, then you really can start to expand out, you know, when you start there. But remember those elements. Rhythm, so simple. Rhythm, melody, harmony. Like, what are we emphasizing? What are we leaning into? What are we relying on at any time? Okay, jumping back over to Zoom. How are we doing on time? Oh, we're good. We have at least 10 minutes to go here. Woo, I'm talking. Okay, good. Oh, somebody threw me a softball. This is good because my brain with all the harmony and stuff is going crazy. Peter, what brand of piano is your favorite? Okay, so I'm a Steinway artist, so they are my favorite, I would say. But I do look at pianos as very individual, you know? And I know every type of instrumentalist says that. Trumpet players are like, oh, every trumpet. Saxophones. Oh, it's the Selmer 63. But it's that particular one. Violins, obviously, but I think piano kind of falls maybe somewhere in between because we look at them as like, okay, this is a Steinway Model B from like kind of the earlier mid-90s. They were building them in a certain way, but like you could find several of these same models, say around the same serial number, same era, that would be pretty different. And one might be my preference and another not. Now, why is that? You know, how the soundboard was constructed, the quality of it, you know, how it was built, yes, but they're probably coming off the factory line pretty similar. So then it becomes like, how were they cared for? Where were they? How much were they played? How much were they kept in tune? How much, you know, expansion, you know, humidity back and forth? And like, that can really affect a piano over time. So I don't like to just blindly be like, I can only play Steinways. I do like Steinways when they're in great shape, of course, but I like other instruments. I love Yamahas too, a Bösendorfer. We have a Bösendorfer over there. I love that instrument. This, like when a Steinway is really set up nicely, like this one is, and it's got, you know, a sound that I like and I connect with, then to me it doesn't get any better than this. But Fazioli's great. Herbie Hancock was right out here at the festival about 100 yards from where I'm sitting right now. About a month ago, I heard him on a beautiful Fazioli in front of like 12,000 people on the street, and that was really cool too. So, okay, I'm moving back a little bit in the questions. I've hit a lot of these. Idea salad, that was a good one. I gotta remember that. We're gonna make a course. Avoid the idea salad. Okay, Giuseppe. Talking about 16th notes, groups of four or three 16th notes. I'm familiar with starting a phrase with 16th notes, but I have some trouble incorporating them into the eighth note phrases. Please advise developing. Okay, so if we think about eighth notes to 16th notes, you know, we want to think about the different tempos that we're practicing this at, because it's not just a matter of, it's not just the staying within tempos that we can play accurately, kind of what our ideals or lines that we're working on, but it's also being willing to practice at different temples, below the temples that we can do it, so that we can start to get the precision and the spacing and the relationship between shifting between eighth notes and 16th notes. So if we go F blues. Eighth notes, right? Now we're gonna go 16th notes. Right to eighth notes. We want to work on them separately, but then we want to start to think about how do we connect them? How do we make that transition where it's just like bam, right? Then there's other things we can do in terms of, you know, that are a little bit more advanced where we're using an eighth note triplet as sort of a bridge between them. We want to be able to get that too, but we also want to be able to go eighth notes to 16th notes. So if I was practicing over an F blues, I might even take it slower. One, two, three, four. So there's the first line, not the greatest line, but now we're going to go 16th notes. That was eighth notes. See, now I already started transitioning back with eighth note triplets, which I wanted to wait to do. That's another good thing with kind of restrictive practicing. It's like, don't get stuck in the ways that you know how to get somewhere you're going. We want to get ourselves a little bit out of the comfort zone. But the fact is that we're keeping a form going, maybe keeping the left hand going if you can, with the you know, two feel or walking bass line, maybe just rootless voicings, or maybe not left hand if you're not there yet. But to have something consistent going in terms of the form while you're shifting over between these two different ways of playing and then taking that with different tempos, that'll start to do it. So, but then also the reality of like the 16th notes, I think we want to think about them as continuous lines for practice, but the reality of when they work best is like, how are you going to break them up, you know? So if I go, so one, two, three, four. Like, where are we leaving the breaks? Where are we starting our line? That's just sort of continuous 16th note lines. But I'm going to start on the upbeat of the first eighth note, right? One, two, three, four. Now I'm going to start back on the one. One, two, three, four. Now I'm going to start on the upbeat, but of the actual quarter note, so it'll be on the eighth note, the and of one. One, two, three, four. So they all probably sound similar to you, but you hear the difference. I'm going to take it one more before we get to the second beat, would be the upbeat of the second eighth note. One, so it's like one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one, two, three, four, one, two, three. It'll be on the three. One, two, three, four. So we want to catch all those different ways to start lines and to practice them. And then, you know, we're kind of restricting things rhythmically, which is good here. So do something. We're restricting ourselves to just varying where we're starting these 16th notes here. So restrict yourself harmonically and melodically. Don't feel like you've got to be inventive with that. We're just going straight 16th notes. I'm just doing it over a minor pentatonic. I'm not doing anything over lines or whatever. Important to like simplify and isolate what it is exactly you're practicing. Now I'll just do it to two. One, two, three, four. Is that right? Yeah. So we've got on the one, three, four. On the end of one 16th note. One, two, three, four. On the upbeat eighth note, the end of one. One, two, three, four. Okay, that's one way to do it that I think would be fun. Schimmel. Rhodes. Okay, cool. Some piano talk on the Zoom. Yeah, so that's Giuseppe in terms of like groups of four or three. That'll start to get you into groups of two. even when you're going continuously, but then you can break it up. That's all like variations of starting on the upbeat of the first 16th, starting on the upbeat of the first 8th, things like that. Okay, I'm going to jump over to YouTube. I think I'm catching most of the Zoom ones. Book-a-doom, dook-a-doom. Tips for getting better at soloing improv, solo jazz piano, left-hand technique, and reading big band charts. Okay, well, that's like pretty much all of jazz piano, so I can't answer all those. So I'll just pick out the last part, reading big band charts. Why would you ever want to do that? Actually, no, that could be important. I don't know, big band for me with piano, this actually might be one of the most interesting approaches to big band for piano, actually trying to read a big band chart. So I don't actually have a lot of experience with this. Strangely enough, I have a little bit more experience reading orchestral scores at the piano. I've had to do this a couple of times, sometimes with my own arrangements for orchestra, which you think would be kind of easy, but it's still hard because like you're looking at this big thing. So the trick to this, my dad is really good at doing this. Like he can sit and look at an orchestral score and just like play it. But what I notice he does, he leaves some things out. So it's like you got to decide what you're going to play. Like you have to be continuously moving along that big band chart and you have to guess at some things. So like the more about like, you know, the more that you understand about how like typical five-part saxophone, you know, like so if you see a pattern of some writing like that, then you're just sort of looking at the top note and then filling in what you figure. I mean, you're still looking at what's happening underneath, but little things like that. And then, you know, in terms of how this stuff is laid out, you might find the parts that you can definitely play. I think looking at the top, which would be like probably the lead trumpet, the first trumpet, or maybe the alto saxophone, depending on how the score is set up. And then what's happening with the bass part. Not necessarily the left hand of the piano, just the bass part. Unless the piano has like chord change, then that's a great sort of cheat code for you to keep what's happening. But the idea is if you can catch what's happening on the outside, I don't know, what's a... Oh, well, we did. That's kind of your minimum... your MVP, your minimum viable playing, right? Is what's, and then can you fill in the stuff that's on the inside? Can you fill in however the trumpets are voicing, you know? Might be like. Then something with the saxophone that you see there and you recognize the four-part writing or whatever, you know? You just have to kind of piece it together. Okay, let me go back and do a couple more. You know what? I'm going to do two more questions because we're already a little bit past an hour. Thank you guys for being here, first of all. And before I hit the last two, let me just say we are here every Friday for the mentor sessions, which are at 2 o'clock Eastern. They start at 2 o'clock Eastern. Open to all members of Open Studio, and it's a very special treat to everybody on YouTube this week. So I hope you enjoyed it. If you like this kind of thing, the other mentor sessions, we got Kevin Hayes next week. That's going to be really cool, talking about, you know, new approaches to voice leading. So a lot of our stuff is more thematic with guest artists like that. But then Adam Manis and myself do these office hour Q&As pretty much almost every month, if not every month, every other month, which are just really fun to just sort of get a bunch of different ideas out there and bring the community together. Speaking of community, let me go back and see if I can see because I got trapped in. Oh, yeah, I see. We got some folks up here. We got quite a few folks. That's always good to see. Okay. I'm going to go back and grab two questions, and then we're going to I'm skipping over ones that I don't know. Sorry. I see the word Barry Harris, and I get worried, so I'm going to leave that to Adam. William asks, have you ever had any issues with pain from playing a lot? I have started playing regularly with a trio and have started getting niggling pain in my right hand. Wondering if my technique isn't great. Any advice? Much appreciated regarding warming up and better technique. Okay, I'm not a doctor. Let me put it out there, obviously, right now. Some things that have worked for me and that I've observed or talked to and heard about working for other folks in terms of, like, thinking about how we can keep ourselves and train ourselves to be in the most relaxed position of strength, right? How can we be super relaxed but not weak and relaxed? Like, how can we be ready to really be in a great position physically to be able to attack the piano without being tight? Like, where do we get that equilibrium? For me, doing some yoga practice has really helped thinking about, like, balance, not only, like, actually being able to balance and strengthen core and that kind of thing, but balance between the left and the right and the sides of our, you know, our sides of our bodies. Even things with, like, some breathing stuff that I've some breath work I've done, where you start to realize that, like, even when we're feeling like we're in really top physical shape for ourselves, the right side of our body and the left side, if it's in our sinuses, if it's in our arms, whatever, are not always equal. So it's not about, like, how do we try to equalize and get them right? It's about observing that and then kind of, like, honoring our body, if you will, but just knowing that that's part of the thing and making adjustments if as needed. And for playing the piano, we always need to make a lot of adjustments because what is required of us, we're not just sitting on... doing the same thing like a mirror all day long. Wouldn't it be easy if we were? We could just line ourselves up here and we treat both hands exactly the same and we do the exact same thing with them. We're not. We're constantly doing different things. We're constantly putting ourselves into a physical situation where we could get out of balance. So nothing wrong with that. Pianists have been doing this for hundreds of years and that's what we want to do, but we want to be aware with that. So what ends up happening is, you know, tension can come into our bodies in an unequal way. A lot of times if we're like, you know, our left hand might, like that kind of playing, might feel a little bit, we might gravitate towards a little bit more of a natural, like strength, but relax and not tensing up because the right hand is where all the action is. So like our brain is going towards that. We're starting to stiffen up. We're starting to like, you know, even like in that side of the shoulder, whatever. So just sort of being aware of that. And like really going back to this sort of when we're practicing, when you're performing, it's very hard to like do anything. But the idea is that we're going to spend a lot more time practicing than performing. So we're thinking about this piano, this bench is low. So just talking about, for me, you know, the physical stuff. Who is in here? Adam Manis, get out of here. No, but the idea is that like, are we in the best possible physical position? Because on the gig, you don't always have that choice. You come up and somebody else has changed something or whatever. But when we're practicing, like, and I'm always thinking about, you know, the elbow being a little bit higher so that the wrist, so that this is flat. And then I would just take something like over a simple pentatonic and like, how relaxed can I be and still execute, you know? And so like, there's always like this kind of stuff that we can do, take ourselves away, relax everything, twist and shout, let it all out, right? And then I think sometimes we kind of know once we get to that part of like, not like, oh, I'm not tense. No, you are tense. It's like, how do we get natural? And then how do we not get, it's not falling apart. It's like, yeah, right? Now I feel a little weird actually, but you know. And then how can we transfer that into the elbow, into the wrist? And then what can happen is like, if this is relaxed but strong, I think that you can, within your fingers, you don't have to worry, again, I'm not a doctor, but you don't have to worry quite as much about tensing up with your fingers, right? If all this is relaxed and strong, you can get to some precision and let the fingers do a little bit more of the work. You've got the weight, you've got the power and everything from behind here. But I found in my experience, and I've observed this with some other pianists too, that once this stuff starts getting tense, either there, and look, I'm a horrible example. I realize that I'm a hypocrite. Let me put that out there. You can look at videos of me all over YouTube, like doing weird stuff or whatever. But I can also say that like when I'm practicing, and I think in which I've never really sat around analyzing this, 'cause I don't look at myself playing like that, but I haven't had any issues beyond, I think it said niggles here, which I would agree with, in terms of like, more from like practicing for too long on something that I'm composing, and then I'm not thinking about playing. I'm like writing, and then I'm like, I feel it, but I stop, and I'm like, I'll stop and stretch. I'll go outside. I'll do some, you know, some different things to like counterbalance what that was I was doing. So I try to really stay aware of that. And then whatever happens when you're playing is what it is. But you're going to spend a lot more time practicing. So I think it's much a much better time to really be aware of it there. And I see some people putting some cool stuff in resources. Probably none of them are doctors, remember that. But there is great stuff, you know, to learn about all this. And also take, I found it useful to take other physical challenges that I've had and thinking about how am I going to apply that to how I physically approach the piano, and as opposed to thinking of like when I sit down as this being a vacuum. This is all a part of how we physically move around, how we strengthen different parts of our body, how we get our core. I mean, this is such an instrument that rewards you from working on having a strong core in terms of like the power and the balance that can bring to your playing. So that's super important. And also just even when you have challenges, like I've had this Achilles issue in my left foot since June, and I've been kind of, I mean, I've been still like running and stuff, but like really trying to think about how to continue on what I'm doing, i.e. if you're feeling some stuff, how do you keep playing when you have to do a gig, when you have to teach, when you have to do something, but not doing things that are detrimental. Like think about other challenges that you've had and how have you dealt with those, if they're athletic or whatever, because there's definitely an athletic element to playing the piano. I think to playing any instrument, it's just, they're all different. Like, we don't think of breath as super important to the piano until you start really thinking about it and what it brings to the table and observing really great pianists and how the attention to detail they have with their breath. But it's different than a trumpet player that is like thinking about breath in terms of like how it exactly relates to phrasing so that they don't run out of oxygen, right? But those same potential benefits we have of thinking about those things, we can bring from different situations that I think can apply. So, all right, that's it. We are done here. Thank you guys so much. Let me just see. I know I said two more questions. If I can see a short one. Boom, 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 boom. Yeah, okay, we're going to end on this one. Chayla, our friend Chayla says, don't keep playing if it hurts. Absolutely. Like, listen to your body. And the same way we can apply that to, you know, listen to what you're hearing as you're working on harmony. Like, it's not just about what's happening here and what you're able to develop with what you can play. It's what you're able to absorb with your ears. That's what ear training is. So it's like, I know it sounds stupid, listen to your ears, listen with your ears. Listen to your body, feel with your body, feel with your hands, and know that that power is within us to really make a lot of the adjustments that we need it. When it gets to the point of acute pain, that's really your body telling you something. But how about listening to our body and honoring our body even before it gets to that point? That can be super helpful too. I'm not a doctor, though. All right, thank you guys so much. We will be back here next week, Friday, with Kevin Hayes. Please join us then. Until then, stay lifted and stay healthy. Stay connected to each other through the music and through this great piano, this great instrument called the piano. And peace and piano. Happy practicing.